At the 1992 Academy Awards, American actress Audrey Hepburn presented that year's honorary Oscar
to the great Indian filmmaker Satyajit Ray.
This made him the first and only Indian to receive that award to date. He's often regarded as one of the best filmmakers to have ever lived, and that's not just my opinion.
What was special to me about Ray, I became a fanatic watching his films.
And the one film that's widely considered his best is
Pathir Panchali.
Pathir Panchali.
In 1956, a year after its release, Pathir Panchali won the Best Human Document Award at Cannes, the National Award for Best Feature Film, and when the prestigious Sight and Sound magazine of the British Film Institute published its list of the 100 greatest films of all time in 2012, only one Indian film made it to the list. Oh, and by the way, this was the very first film Satyajit Ray made. So, how did a first-time filmmaker with a fairly inexperienced crew and cast, a minuscule budget, and no formal training in filmmaking make one of the best Indian films of all time? Pathir Panchali is a beloved Bengali novel written by Bibhuti Bhushan Bandopadhyay. In a classic story of a poor family struggle in rural Bengal, told from the perspective of the youngest member, Oppu. It deals with the tragedies that befall them, including the death of Oppu's sister and eventually his father's, and how he comes of age. In 1950, Ray, who was working as a book cover designer in an ad firm in Calcutta, was sent by his ad firm to London for 6 months. There, he happened to be exposed to international cinema. There was one film in particular that inspired him the most. Italian filmmaker Vittorio De Sica's The Bicycle Thieves is a classic tale of family, morality, and poverty. But what interested Satyajit Ray the most was the way it had been made. After watching the film, in his own words, Ray wondered who said inexperienced people cannot be made to act? Who said one can't shoot in the middle of the rains? Who said makeup is mandatory? These methods of filmmaking were largely unheard of in India. Shoots would almost always take place in a large studio with harsh and flat lights and with a lot of makeup. And casting non-actors was a very alien concept. But with these new insights, he headed back to India with a fully formed idea in his head. Pathir Panchali had to be made. If Ray had to make the film his way, he would need a team that he could trust. And so, he started looking. The first to join him was Bansi Chandragupt, a Kashmiri painter who decided to pursue art direction in cinema. Before Pathir Panchali, he had only one film to his name. He and Ray would eventually go on to collaborate for almost 3 decades. Next up was Subrata Mitra, the cinematographer. He was then an amateur photographer who had never handled a motion picture camera in his life. But Satyajit showed a lot of confidence in him and told him that a movie camera is just pictures in motion. Even the film's editor, Dulal Datta, was only a few films old in the industry. Ray roped in a trustworthy production controller, Anil Chaudhary, for the film, who would also go on to work with him for decades to come. So, finally, they had the primary crew. Now they needed the funding. Ray had already finished the first draft of the script on his way back to India. Along with this, he also made elaborate sketches on a lot of the shots and scenes he intended to film. This wasn't and still isn't commonplace in our industry. But Ray's perfectionism did not immediately find takers. Almost every producer he met agreed that it was a great idea, but didn't think an inexperienced director like himself would make it reach its maximum potential. After months of struggling to find a producer, Ray eventually decided to start shooting the film and use his own money. With this money, they could only shoot a single scene. Eventually, they found a distributor willing to pay in advance to shoot another portion. To help with production, Satyajit's wife Bijoya even offered to pawn her gold bangles. As the shoot progressed, the distributor, who promised to finance the film, dropped out. Suddenly, the shoot came to a grinding halt. Ray went from pillar to post to try and find another producer for the film. Ray even sold his most valuable and prized possession, his art and his records, but nothing materialized. Help then came from very unexpected quarters. Seeing the crew struggle so long and hard to secure financial aid, Ray's mother stepped in. She had a friend who was on very friendly terms with the most powerful man in West Bengal, Dr. B.C. Roy, the chief minister. She hoped that the state government might be inclined to fund the film if they had seen some of the shots that were filmed. Somehow, it was arranged that the chief minister watched the incomplete film. A single viewing convinced Dr. Roy to have the state government fund the film. So finally, after 8 long months, filming resumed. But even after this, the remainder of filming wasn't a cakewalk. The arrangement with the government was that the funds would be paid in installments. So the shoots would happen in small bursts, during which the government scrutinized the bills that Ray presented. It would often mean months of gaps between shoots. So to those of you who don't understand the specifics of film shooting, almost no film is shot sequentially. Scenes are broken up according to location, actors' availability, or what time of day is required for that shot. So maintaining the continuity is very, very important. Now, imagine maintaining continuity after a gap of 8 months. And that too, with an almost amateur cast. The main characters of the film were Oku, the protagonist, his father, his older sister, and a distant relative
who was living with the family at that time. The role of Oku's mother was essayed by Karuna Banerjee,
who's a theatre actor but with no film experience. While Kanu Banerjee was a trained actor, neither of the kids were. Satyajit and Anil searched Calcutta schools for the perfect protagonist. They even put out advertisements in the paper. Yet, they couldn't find the one they were looking for. Once again, his wife, Bijoya, came to his rescue. Ray had conveyed the image in his mind of the boy he was looking for to her. One day, while she was looking out of a window, she saw a few boys playing on a rooftop near her house. Among them was 8-year-old Subir Banerjee, and he was exactly the boy that Ray had described to her. She ran to him and announced, "I found Oppo," and that was it. With a motley crew, disrupted production schedule, and abundant financial woes, the film was finally completed and ready for the world to see. Upon release, the film was met with universal acclaim. The Times of India called it pure cinema. According to Ray's biographer, Marie Seton, in a letter written to the New York Times, one of the readers proclaimed that it was the most beautiful and sensitive film that she had ever seen. Ray would go on to make many, many, many classical films, but this one is always considered his very best. Recently, its original negatives, which were almost completely destroyed in a fire in 1993, were painstakingly restored in Los Angeles by the Criterion Collection. And today, we can watch this film in cutting-edge 4K quality. That's how Paathir Panchali continues to inspire generations and generations of young filmmakers, and will continue to do so as long as cinema still exists.